Thanks, everybody. Welcome to RSA 2014. I'm going to be talking today about intelligence-driven security and why you should be implementing that in your enterprise. So I'm with CrowdStrike, and we believe at CrowdStrike that you don't have a malware problem. You have a lot of things that may look like a malware problem. You have malware, you've got adversaries with command and control and all of these things on your network, but what that comes down to is not a malware problem. You actually have an adversary problem. And an adversary problem is a very different type of problem to start to solve on your enterprise. You need to use intelligence in order to start to look at how to deal with these adversaries that are inside your infrastructure. So who are these adversaries that I speak of? You may have seen that we've talked about a couple of them publicly, things like Energetic Bear and Anchor Panda. But at the core, adversaries are humans. It doesn't matter if you're dealing with Zeus or a Citadel-type infection. There is some human that built that malware, that set up that infrastructure, that put together all of the components that are needed to make that a successful attack. And the adversaries that we look at can be broken up, really, in my opinion, into two different categories. So we have targeted attackers. Sorry, I'm used to having slides behind me. targeted attackers, and their motivation can vary. They might be interested in performing a disruptive attack, negatively impacting your ability to serve content to customers, or perhaps take some of your systems offline so that you can't perform your critical business functions. They might want to steal intellectual property, get access to source code or to signing certificates or things like that. But they need to get in. They need to get a foothold on your infrastructure. They need a way to operate. They're going to need to perform privilege escalation attack. They're going to need to move laterally. They're going to have to do a lot of things that expose themselves during the course of their operation. The other type of attacker is what I would call spray and pray, or prey, if you want to see the pun in the slide there. And they don't really care who they target. They're going to compromise a website with an exploit kit. They're going to try and hit whoever might be passing by. And they're probably looking to steal account credentials or to use that machine's resources for sending out spam or conducting a denial of service type attack. And the more machines they compromise, the more victims that they find, the more they win. And their motivation can vary as well. Similar to the target attacker, it could be a disruptive attack. They might be engaged in something like a denial of service. It could be a crypto locker type attack where they encrypt the contents of your system and then try to ransom the access to that data back. And they might even be trying to steal things like account credentials or perhaps intellectual property. And I think we've seen some of the criminals move recently to a very different kind of dynamic where they used to use the spray and pray approach. And now we're seeing that they're even taking a page from the targeted attack book. And what used to be leveraged as a criminal attack is now manifesting itself similarly to a targeted attack with lateral movement, privilege escalation, and some sort of target inside the enterprise. So one of the things that we focus on with an intelligence-driven security approach is adversary categorization. If you understand what the tactics and techniques of the adversary are, if you understand how they operate, if you understand that that there are different things that go into what they need to be successful in their attack, and those things are repeatable. I've often heard people talk about systems administrators and say that a systems administrator, a good systems administrator, is inherently lazy. And so they're going to script things and do whatever they can to make their job easier. And attackers do the same thing. And because of this, they reuse passwords. They reuse mutex names. They have a favorite registry key. And these TTPs, tactics, techniques, and procedures that these adversaries use, they might change a lot of different aspects of it, but there's something that they're going to inherently leave behind. And that's where we start to get into this categorization situation. My understanding what malware they use, what ISPs they prefer for their command and control, knowing what domains they like to use when they're registering their command and control, knowing the mutexes, the registry keys, all of these things allows you to start to categorize these adversaries and track them over time. And that is because they are human. So there's a couple of different categories that an adversary could fall into, and this really ties back to their motivations. So in the case of state-sponsored adversaries, they've got a very unique kind of style, a signature, if you will, that allows you to kind of track that and start to associate that with a nation state. Some of these things that we look at with nation states, they tend to work normal business hours, whereas more criminal motivated or other types of attackers don't keep regular schedules. Many of the nation state groups that we track, we can track them clocking in at 8 a.m. and clocking out at 5 p.m., and they generally take about an hour lunch. And when we start to line up those adversary activities with time periods, we could even start to figure out what region they're in. So if they're working 8 to 5 UTC plus 4, that's Moscow, or if it's 8 to 5 in Beijing time zone, it's very different style, and it's something that we could start to track. Then there's criminal-motivated attackers. They tend to have different patterns, different behaviors. They use a completely different set of malware in most cases. We also track hacktivists and nationalist type groups, and they have different motivations. So many of you might have heard of the Syrian Electronic Army. Their motivations have been propaganda. They try to have message control. They've moved into some newer techniques, but they originally really started off with trying to control the message around the conflict in Syria, which began in March 2011. And there might be some others out there. Insider threat is another one that has kind of a different profile, a different kind of look to it. And then once we've kind of categorized at a broad level, who are these adversaries? So we use a system where we use animals for nation states that are kind of reflective of that nation state. And I'll talk about this in a minute. But for example, Panda for us is what we use for all Chinese nation state sponsored activity. For a criminal group, we use something called Spider. And for an activist kind of nationalist profile, we'll typically use the name Jackal. And so this becomes a cryptonym system where we have two cryptonyms, one delineating the group and the other being the origin and the motivation of that attacker. So we can get into different categories, subcategories of these attackers and start to look at what implants do they use when they get onto a system. So our energetic bear actor uses an implant that we call Havex. And that's unique to that actor. We don't see that being used by others. So that becomes one of those TTPs that we can use to bucket that adversary. There could be infrastructure overlap. So one of the things that we do is look at different adversary campaigns and see was there overlap between the same command and control node. And that can allow us to start to take two seemingly disparate attacks and put them together based off of some of these overlaps. Delivery and exploit is another one. So exploits can be pretty expensive, and adversaries don't typically share them. So very often, you'll see an adversary start off with one type of exploit. It's unique to them. They either developed it or they paid for it. And then we can watch that over time as it starts to proliferate. A good example, we had an adversary we called Viceroy Tiger, which was originating out of India. And that adversary we observed with a new zero-day vulnerability a couple of months ago. And through that, we actually were able to trace that backwards and start to look at the supply chain and see that there was a criminal group that was actually using that exploit beforehand in the same region, and then watch that progress and change over time. So that's kind of how we were able to start to pull the thread and see where maybe that attack originated from. Now, there is some complications here. So PlugX, if you're familiar with that, is a pretty well-known now implant that tends to have a focus around China. And initially, a lot of people thought that that was one adversary group because it was kind of a unique implant. What we found is that that actually moved across several different groups. And so what a lot of people had in the community attributed to one threat actor actually was tied to numerous different actors. So you can get complications, and you have to be very careful when relying on some of these indicators as a measure of attribution. So some of the things that we can use for categorization. Implant. So the configuration of that implant. What mutex does it use? What many of these have the campaign ID, so you'll actually see it'll say something related to the victim in the campaign ID or something along those lines. Build times are very telling too. Now they can of course be spoofed and faked, but a build time, you don't see adversaries normally spoofing that, and when they do, they tend to do it in an inconsistent manner, or maybe they use the same build time every time that they spoof it, and that then becomes another indicator that you can use to track them. Delivery. So how did that exploit, how did that implant, how did that malware show up? And what metadata is there around that? What SMTP servers did they use to get a spear phish in? What sites did they choose to victimize for a strategic web compromise or commonly a watering hole? You can look at the weaponization, so look at the exploits that are in there. Look at the artifacts of that exploit. How was it built? Was there fuzzing involved? Was there, did they take a shell code from some other implant? Shell code's actually kind of expensive and difficult to manifest itself, especially when you have ROP chains and things like that. And adversaries tend to reuse that stuff. So when you start looking at different attacks and looking at the same ROP chain and things like that, you can start to add that. Now, each one of these things is starting to get cumulative, right? So I'm adding different aspects from the implant, from the exploit, from the delivery, and then from the tools that they use once they get into the system. Do they modify anything on the system? What do they use to dump hashes? What do they use for lateral movement, privilege escalation? Look at the hashes of those. We often see adversaries taking common tools like Netcat and then localizing them for their own language. That's a pretty good giveaway as to who's behind an attack. So when you take all of these things together, you're able to start to pull together the TTPs and start to build that category, the motivation, and what goes into to this attacker. And so that allows us to do some interesting things. So for example, because we track over 50 different adversaries today, and we look at who they target, how they target, we're able to start to look at, by sector, what adversaries are targeting that sector. And this gets into the intelligence-driven security. How do you take this information and use that to appropriately defend yourself? So let's talk about some of the adversaries targeting the financial sector as an example. So China, we've got a number of different ones. We call Comment Panda, which is often called APT1 or Comment Crew or Comment Team. Vixen Panda, a number of different Chinese adversaries. Deep Panda is one that we've got very good attribution on, tying back to an actual individual who is associated with development of that implant. India, Viceroy Tiger. This is another adversary that's been very, very active over the last year. Some interesting indications that tie back to specific company and its infrastructure. We've seen this group not only targeting things like Pakistani nuclear programs, but also dissidents in other countries. And so it seems like there's a nation state and a financial implication to this group, and they have targeted the financial sector. North Korea. Anybody know what a Kalima is? A Kalima is a mythical flying horse. And that's actually the official animal of North Korea. So whereas most countries have a real animal, like an eagle or some sort of some actual animal, they have a mythical flying horse, which was just the kind of crazy we came to expect from the DPRK. So Silent Kalima is an adversary that we've tracked in North Korea, conducting not only sophisticated attacks that result in damage and disruption, but they're also using the same infrastructure for espionage. We found implants that have keywords in Korean for US military targets. So interesting things that were there. And they use that same infrastructure to target the financial sector and to do criminally motivated attacks, which is kind of interesting when you start to look at some of the other things that as a state DPRK is involved in, things like counterfeiting and other types of activity. And then, as expected, the activists like to target the financial sector as well. So Deadeye Jackal is what we call the Syrian Electronic Army. We call them that because we want to imply both the intention and the fact that it's not tied to a state. So this is an activist group with a political message, and it's not necessarily tied to a Syrian state-sponsored activity, but certainly nationalist-type activity. And, of course, as we would expect, criminals. So we have a number of different criminal groups that we track. that target the financial sector, and they have different motivations within those types of attacks. So by taking these things, we could start to look at what tools do they use, what exploits do they use, how do they get in, what do they go after when they get in. And if you know this information, this intelligence, you can use that to effectively protect yourself. You can start to instrument your intrusion detection systems. You can look for things inside of your firewall, inside of your DNS resolution. You can look for host-based indicators. You can bring all of this information to bear and use it to identify these types of attackers. So if you're a financial sector institution, here's a list of attackers that are likely going to be targeting you. And if you know how they operate, you can leverage that to help protect yourself. But it's not just about protection. Think about all of the other things that you do for enterprise security that you can leverage this information for. So for example, a penetration test. You could have a consultant come in and do a penetration test whereby they run through every possible exploit and Metasploit and Canvas and Core Impact and things like that. Or you could say, who's most likely to target me? Who's going to do the most damage? And let's do an attack using those tools, those techniques, and those procedures and see how effective we are at detecting it and how effective it would be against our infrastructure. And those are the types of things that we start to look at for intelligence-driven security, which is what I'm up here on a soapbox about. So kind of wrap it up. Your enterprise is being targeted. But it's being targeted by humans, and humans are predictable. You can start to understand how they operate, how they think, and build your defenses around that. Out-of-the-box security solutions aren't catching anything. So I'd say one of the biggest things that we see when we work with some of our customers is that they've bought that IDS, they've bought that advanced malware protection device, but when they plugged it in, it didn't do all the magic things that they expected it to because they needed to understand who the threat actors were and to start tune this thing and to set it up to focus on finding the things that they care about. There is a lot of noise, and by using intelligence-driven security, you can start to look at what is actually affecting your bottom line, what's impacting your business, what's the thing that's going to cause you to not go to that barbecue on a Friday afternoon because some adversary has gotten into your infrastructure. And if you focus on those things first, you can start to drive down that noise and really care about the things that are going to impact your business. And most importantly, you need to understand who's targeting you and what you can do to defend against that. So that is my presentation. I'll keep it short and to the point, really just looking to start getting people thinking about taking intelligence, finding it in their infrastructure, and then feeding it back into their existing security infrastructure in order to effectively identify and prevent these types of attacks. Thank you.